That's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
For those of you who dreamed of a future full of flight and limitless possibility, your time has come.
Come with me.
You ready for your flight to JFK?
And you'll be in a world of pure imagination.
Blade. Fly the future today.
Fantastic video. Rob, great to see you. How are you?
Great seeing you. We're doing well. Working hard.
How's life as a listed company CEO?
It is definitely has its challenges, but it also is exciting. So we're really glad to be here. And thanks for showing that video. We actually added an alliance last week, as you may have read, with Embraer's Eve platform. So the alliances continue with the OEM. So we're very excited about that.
Yeah, it's hard work keeping up with all of them. How often are you checking the share price? Rob?
The hope is that we focus on our business and the share price will take care of itself. But, in the beginning, every now and then people do sneak on their smartphone or their computer.
So you launched Blade in 2014 after you were fed up with the glamour of the music industry. You wanted to get into helicopters. And this was way before most people were looking at what have until now been called eVTOLs. And first, you hate that branding, don't you?
I guess I'd like to say is, with Beta Technologies, with Kyle and the great team over there, and even with Whisk, we like the name EVA. It rolls off the tongue better. It's electric vertical aircraft, says it all. We'll see who adopts it. But there's a lot of time. We have a lot of time to worry about that. Right now, we just got to get these aircraft, made, certified, and flying.
I agree with you. To be honest, I personally dislike the L on the end of ETOL. I think landing should be taken as a given.
Yes, we hope so. I think we decided we had a board meeting where most had a French pronunciation. They called it eVTOL. So at that point, we realized that it was time for a little bit of a brand shift. So we use the term EVA, and we welcome anybody in the industry to use it as well.
What's exciting about EVAs is that when you first came up with Blade as an idea, it was all about helicopters, wasn't it?
Well, it really was. It was never called Blade Helicopters. I think that in my prior life at Sony, I spent a fair amount of time looking at lithium ion battery procurement strategies and alliances. And Sony, obviously, through digital still cameras and portable gaming and cell phones, spent a lot of time on lithium batteries. And it was clear the battle on the ground was going to move to the air. So the view was start with helicopters today, build the infrastructure, get the customer experience right, get the brands, get people flying, and also have the technology from consumer to cockpit. And then at some point, have an asset swap and do that on an asset-light basis. We don't own or operate any aircraft. So that's really was always the business model. And that way we have flexibility two ways. Number one, if EVA ends up coming a little later, we still keep building our business. But we also have the benefit of being a little bit of an index play on all these manufacturers because our routes are going to change, our mission requirements are going to change. So one platform doesn't do it all for us. And to the extent timelines extend, we'll have other partners who are probably, sooner in the timeline to rely upon.
And you have signed agreements with three major OEMs already, haven't you? How did you choose them?
Correct. I think that, we have a team here that assesses the technology. And obviously, the most important thing is whether it's right for our missions and the geographies that we have, and frankly, the first, with Beta Technologies, they're in Vermont, they're in the Northeast, they understand the cold weather and the kind of just the kind of terrain and weather that we deal with. We liked the idea of being able to land like a fixed wing aircraft because we do a lot of city to airport type routing, the distance. timeline, great team. And also there's a lot of chemistry that has to happen with these manufacturers because we're really working together in the sense that, you know, the passenger, you know, experience, the things that we deal with every day, everything from, you know, tarmac safety to physically challenge people to, you know, vibration, seat rake, all the things that, you know, just flying tens and tens of thousands of people over the years, you know, you get a sense for what you need. So you got to think, remember this, that helicopters were really never meant for consumer flying, right? You know, the Sikorsky is actually a Black Hawk helicopter. And, you know, at some point someone said, you know, why don't we put leather seats in this and make this a executive helicopter? You get in a helicopter, you're standing, you step onto something that is very narrow. There's a float that says don't step. You're putting in headphones. You may not be able to talk to the pilot. It's sometimes uncomfortable. You may have, you know, 4-point seat belts. They really are meant for, you know, news gathering, offshore drilling, so many different things except actually commuting. So what's exciting to us is to be able to work with manufacturers so they really understand not only the experience that the passengers need, but what it takes for us in terms of Blade to keep those missions moving, keep turning those helicopter flights so we can get the most out of an aircraft in a limited amount of time. So if you think about, you know, Blade Airport in New York City, which just relaunched after COVID pause, you know, we had to turn those helicopters sometimes every you know, 3 minutes. And that we can improve upon that by working closely with the manufacturers in terms of the ergonomics and the design of the aircraft, baggage compartments, all that. And we have all that data.
The data is really important though, isn't it? Because we had a great chat on day one with Yesh from Hyundai. And Hyundai is looking around the world trying to work out where it's going to start and looking at all the different opportunities and places where the infrastructure is right. Have you pretty much decided on where you'll be implementing VTOL from day one? Oh, sorry, I didn't say VTOL, I said EVA.
Blade is never going to be, especially in the early days of EVA as it rolls out, you're never gonna see a map with just tons of dots all over the world. We wanna pick the largest markets to be number one in those large markets. And right now, the biggest opportunity we clearly see is in the Northeast, the entire Northeast corridor. We obviously see opportunities in the West Coast. We, as you know, we launched operations in India through a joint venture. And it's really about reducing friction. In India, we turn a 5-hour drive into a 30-minute flight. In New York, we turn a 2-hour drive into a 5-minute flight to JFK at times. And we're now absolutely shattering Uber Black pricing in New York City because of the lack of drivers right now. We're in this very interesting stage where an Uber Black can be $230 to the airport, where our product is $195, or with an airport pass, only $95. And, you know, pre-pandemic, we were flying to all three airports from all three Blade lounges in New York, 12 hours a day, 6 days a week. And it's a very powerful product, but it's about reducing friction. And it's also about where there's existing infrastructure, because we're firm believers in the fact that new infrastructure is going to come after EVA arrives. So what we want to do is, as we transition from helicopters to EVA, is to show the stakeholders, local governments, community boards, flyers, that EVAs are in fact quiet, safe, and emission free. And with that, that will catalyze the building of new vertiports that'll dramatically increase our addressable market. But until then, it's the existing heliports and airports where we're building terminals and making acquisitions that EVA will be flying in the beginning. But even today, Alistair, I can tell you, last year, I think actually in 2019, 28 million people either arrived at JFK Airport, at all the New York City airports, or departed the New York City airports, where Manhattan was either their ultimate destination or their point of departure to the airport. So that's a huge addressable market for us. And so we see a lot of opportunity in New York, a lot of opportunity in the Northeast, going all the way up the Northeast corridor. We see opportunities in Florida. We have to be systematic about it. And our first goal is to get airport up and running. We've already talked about commuter products from Westchester to New York and to the airports. I also think that the usage patterns post-COVID are changing as well. Many of our leisure routes were really only on weekends. They're now seven-day-a-week businesses. So, for instance, this April, we were flying on leisure routes 7 days a week. We never did that before. In fact, we did publicly disclose that our revenues in April for 2021 were not only obviously higher than 2020 during COVID, but higher than 2019. So the usage patterns of this kind of hybrid remote work environment where someone may be spending, you know, 8 days at home in an extended suburb that could be up to 90 miles away or more, coming to the office 1 or 2 days, you know, 1 or 2 days every 10 days, sometimes flying for, say, $295, which is the price of their commuter pass to some of these leisure markets 90 miles away. That's pretty affordable if you're doing it only once every couple of weeks.
Also, you get used to it, don't you? Like, commuting's great while you do it every day, and you get used to it. You don't question your hour and a half.
In traffic right now, in New York and in other cities, are at pre-pandemic levels. And a lot of people bought cars during the pandemic. There's a lot of people who are no longer taking public transportation. So the roads are pretty tight right now.
Are you interested in looking at other joint venture partners around the world?
Yeah, I think that if there's, you know, call it a obviously there's a high level of difficulty in terms of doing starting operations in India. So we would not do that without a local partner. And they had the opportunity to actually help us build heliports and terminals in India in conjunction with the Ministry of Aviation. I look at a lot of other opportunities in other countries. We'd love to be in Europe. As you know, say in London, you know, right now there's only the Battersea heliport, which isn't perfectly convenient for a lot of people. Paris, you know, we wish there was more infrastructure. So there are going to be certain cities that will be EVA first in terms of urban air mobility. And there are other cities where we could relight existing helipads, or they have a helipad or airport infrastructure that works. But it's not as ubiquitous as you may think.
No, and you're right. And I think Europe's fairly unhelicopter friendly. And I guess that's one of the issues is noise. And you're a founding member of the Alliance for Quiet and Electric Aviation, aren't you? How does that work?
Yeah, so that's an alliance of people who have interest in preserving existing infrastructure so that we can accommodate next generation aircraft. Because if this infrastructure goes away, I don't think a lot of it will be able to return. It's very, very difficult to build this kind of infrastructure. Some of the airports we land at are over 100 years old. Many of the heliports we land at are over 40 years old. And it's critical that we allow this infrastructure to remain. So we're in a position when the new quiet electric aircraft are here, we can, again, prove to the local communities that these are not only quiet, emission-free, and safe, but also hopefully at some point much more affordable transportation for a wider group of the population than currently enjoys helicopters and other small aircraft.
You've also launched in the last few years Blade Medi Mobility. Do you want to explain that? Because that's also part of demonstrating to communities what you can offer, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, when you think about, you know, ESG right now, it's not only about, you know, our plans to shift from jet engine aircraft to electric aircraft, but it's also, you know, how we can use our platform to help people. And I would say as of last year, we're now the largest air transporter of human organs for transplants in the Northeast. And that's really exciting business because we're actually improving the efficacy of transplants, because especially say in New York City, where people used to take maybe a jet to Teterboro with a doctor, or a bunch of doctors and organs, they would then get an ambulance and fight traffic in New Jersey through Manhattan. So for instance, we can actually depart literally 100 feet away from Langone Medical Center at the Blade Terminal on the east side and say, go straight to Philadelphia. That by helicopter, that used to be an ambulance trip to Teterboro, transferring the organ and the doctors to a jet, and then the same thing on the return. And we'd also land on hospital helipads as well. So it really is exciting. So to increase the efficacy in terms of the amount of travel time going down, but also the price. We believe that we're saving at least many missions up to half their normal cost of doing these transplant surgeries. So you understand, doctors will go to a hospital and extract an organ, then bring it back for transplant. So it's a very complicated process. But what it also does is it allows our operators to actually amortize more costs over their equipment. So during the day, an aircraft will be doing missions for commuters. And in the evening, a different crew will come in and be using the helicopter for hospital work. So that helps reduce the cost, not only for the operators and for Blade, but ultimately for our customers who are going to fly us, say, to the airport or to other destinations.
I like the fact you're talking about, you've always talked about a partnership with operators and giving them more lift. Are you not tempted to buy one?
No, I think, I do not envy operators, and I certainly don't envy manufacturers. We want to focus on what we're good at, and that is this end-to-end experience for the flyer. That not only that goes from when you first hear about Blade through marketing, when you walk into one of our terminals, going to security, baggage assessment, safety, the logistics and the recovery in case of weather or mechanicals, the booking experience, the data we need to figure out what kind of routes, offering that entire platform, and obviously the trust that our flyers put in us every day in terms of how we select and diligence our operators. That's a lot to do. I can't even imagine trying to build an aircraft. Can't imagine owning a company that has to, train pilots, maintain aircraft, buy parts. We know what we do. We want to stick to our knitting.
But when you look at EVA OEMs, I'm just throwing in acronyms now, trying to build aircraft and operate them, do you think they'll continue doing that? Or do you just see it being, like Boeing or United, that they'll eventually split up?
Well, I think it depends what the objective is. I believe that, I think infrastructure is much tougher to build than I believe many people think. So our rule of thumb here is if someone allows you to build a vertiport in their community, they probably don't need one. So it's just kind of way it is. So if you want to go to, somewhere outside, outside Dallas, outside Orlando, and you want to actually showcase your technology and create a route to showcase the technology, I would understand why a manufacturer wants to do that. If you want to actually build, a network of routes and have enough customers where you're taking economic risk on every flight, because obviously you need a certain type of utilization, it's a different type of business. I can't judge whether they will be able to do it or not. I would say for us, that would be boiling the ocean. But I understand why they want to do it. I think they want to prove that it works, and they have clearly have a vision as to how they want it to operate. But they're also very different skill sets, as you pointed out, with the airlines being a manufacturer and then also being an air carrier or an arranger of flights. But we hope they can do it. We think, if this is going to be what Morgan Stanley calls a $500 billion industry in 5 years or whatever the numbers are today, we're going to need as many manufacturers and as many operators and arrangers as we can. So the more, the better.
You went in, you launched in 2014, which wasn't that long ago, but probably feels like it for you. You had some fantastic investors from the start, but the cash targeting the sector then was a lot less than now.
Correct.
What do you feel when you see billions pouring in? Is that good for you, or do you worry that you're going to have competitors coming up against you?
Well, we started this company, from 2014 to now, we probably spent about $38 million, and yet through our public offering, we raised gross proceeds about $360 million. That's a lot of money to us. And that has been earmarked for acquisitions of infrastructure, transactions with operators, joint ventures, route expansion. So we believe, especially with an asset-light model, we have a lot of cash. to go execute upon our business plan, and also to be opportunistic beyond the things that we even see today. Again, when you think about the billions being poured into this industry, a lot of that is design and manufacturing. I mean, you think about these companies that are building EVA, these would normally be R&D projects in giant, large aerospace companies. So they're going to, they know they need a fortune. And frankly, they've raised a lot of money. So hopefully they're off to a great start. From our perspective, this is like Operation Warp Speed for EVA. The amount of money that's been put in this industry is only going to help it get catalyzed to get to certification faster, better technology, lower costs for consumers, more opportunities for companies like Blade to have a selection of aircraft. Because I think one of the things that also differentiates us from, say, a manufacturer that is operating their own platform is, even today with helicopters, the helicopter that it goes to a hospital to pick up an organ is different than the one that'll take you to the airport, that's different than the one that'll take you to Boston. We will need a portfolio as well of EVA, the right equipment for the right mission. It won't be one platform.
When you say infrastructure, would you look at buying vertiports or FBOs?
Absolutely. It's definitely on the roadmap. Existing infrastructure, we believe, is critical to the launch of EVA. And it's obviously critical for us to have improve our economics with conventional aircraft and to improve the flyer experience. Most of our terminals are proprietary, and the ability to aggregate our passengers, do safety checks, do security check-in, baggage assessment, assemble them, put them in the right seats, obviously weight and balance it. That's a very complicated process that we've managed to figure out how to scale. And you can't do that in a parking lot, and you can't do that in a general aviation terminal.
And of course, one of the beauties of your partnership is you now have some very smart FBO investors with you your board. We've got an anonymous question. How much percentage of money goes for environment protection? I think they're talking about your offsetting there, I think. Is that right?
Yes. We are carbon neutral through carbon through offsets. I can't tell you how much it costs us, but we are carbon neutral as a company even today. Pre-EVA. And what's, I think, is interesting about that is we wanted to make sure that when we entered into this program to become carbon neutral, that it wasn't just buying these kind of very opaque offsets that people really don't know what they are. We actually fund programs in the places we operate. So, for instance, there's a project in the Bronx where there's a landfill, and we collect methane gas from that landfill and take it away so it can be used for other purposes. And I think that actually helps us with our flyers, because it's not just like writing a check. We actually think really hard about what projects we're funding wherever possible.
And actually, it's amazing how large parts of the suburbs used to smell of methane in New York. It's brilliant, Rob. It's so exciting seeing it. Having watched you from the start, it's so exciting now talking to you as a CEO of NASDAQ. I guess, and I've just been told methane's odorless, so, but at least by Luke from Daedalen, it doesn't surprise me that he'd know that. it did have a smell, I'm probably missing. Rob, finally, when do you think you'll be launching EVA?
I think that we signed a deal recently with MagnaX, which I think you showed in your recent video. Amphibious seaplanes are a big part of our business. So that will be a much faster certification process. They've come out and said 2023, and that will be an extremely quiet aircraft, but it is not EVA. And then in 2024, we'd hope to expect deliveries of our first passenger appropriate Beta Technologies Alia aircraft, which we're really excited for. So that's the date they have that. We projected that it would begin in 2025 in terms of our financial projections. So we have a little cushion there, but we're glad that the pressure's on and everybody's keeping to some very, very, important dates.
And what date do you think you'll have autonomous flights?
I have no idea. Okay, talk to our partners at WISC about that. I'm sure
Gary's actually on the next panel, so I'll let my colleague ask. Rob, always a pleasure. Really great to see you. And I hope I can one day visit you in New York again. Thanks so much.
Great. Thank you so much.